morning, so hopefully you can all get your questions and comments in. So I'm Amy Rivers, I'm the chair of the Historic District Commission. This is Beth Watson and Marion Chambers. So let's see, so I want to just start with, this is a very preliminary discussion of a potential expansion of the district. We're just gathering feedback. We might do try to do a smaller expansion than what we've originally proposed, depending on what people say. We could also consider adjusting these things to be exempt from review, if that's the feedback we get from people. You know, for example, if everybody from A Street really wants to be in the district, but everybody from B Street doesn't, we could always just say, okay, we'll just take A Street. We don't need to do B Street if people don't want it. So we really appreciate everyone's feedback, and we're going to adjust accordingly. We're also working on creating design guidelines for the district about what would be allowed and not allowed by guidelines. We think that would make people more comfortable with being in the district if they knew exactly what the expectation, or more closely what the expectation would be. And this is just kind of at the beginning third of the timeline. We've done some preliminary stuff. We've had a historical survey done of properties around the district. Got some recommendations from professionals, but the next step is a public forum. Then we have to write up a report to the Mass Historical Commission and have a big public hearing with our final recommendation. And then it would go to town meeting. And then obviously the town can vote it up or down. It's not our choice, it's the town's choice. So right now we have about 25 properties in the district, and we proposed a pretty big expansion. But again, we want to hear from everyone what they would like to see or not see happen. So I guess I'll invite people to give their comments and questions now. Anything they want to ask or comment on? Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. Why aren't you including Route 85 to Cedar Street?
Well, so we were afraid to ask for too much, I think. And so would you be in favor of us including some of Cedar Street?
And one other thing, I live on Beach Street, so my house I had built in 30 years ago, so there's nothing historic about my home.
Yeah.
But the home next to me is 100 years or more, and it had a for sale sign on for a long time, but it doesn't seem to be moving. If somebody wanted to knock it down and put up a new house, this would keep them from doing that. And I'm wondering if there would be funding involved to help to preserve these, because to give someone an incentive to keep them the way they are.
So, you want to write that down? I don't think there is funding available for private homes. If it's a public building like Center School, we can probably get some funds for grants for that. But I don't think if it's a private home, we can.
Sometimes there's funding if the property is on the National Register of Historic Places, but that's not what this is. That's a whole different process.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't think that's going to be on the Historic Register.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, if we include B Street in the Historic District, it would kind of tie the hands of whoever wanted to change something there.
So there's definitely pros and cons. We do understand that sometimes homes are just beyond saving, that they might be in really rough shape and might have to come down. But they would at least become for us for design review, so that whatever is built in its place would kind of fit in with the streetscape. But right, sometimes something's got a horrible, you know, flood or fire, or like there was one on Grove Street that the roof was caved in the back and it couldn't be saved. But right now, when that happens, if an older home that's not in the district is demolished, there's no design review process for a private home, so just they can build whatever they want. Sometimes it's awesome, you know, whatever.
But they do have to go before the Historical Commission, but that just will institute a 6-month delay, and then after that, there's not much that can happen.
Right.
That can prevent it.
Excuse me, what was the comment about 85 Cedar Street?
Oh, I'm sorry. Why Cedar Street wasn't included? And also
Cedar Street is a street you see when you pass through town. It's right there. I noticed some of these other streets, like Bathurst Street, right nearby. I wouldn't know what's on there.
Yeah. And then,
Cedar
Street, and you own a newer home on the same street, right?
30 years, if not new, but.
Maybe we should write down the treatment of newer homes.
Yeah, newer homes.
Yeah, because we would never make your home more historic. Like, it just is what it is. So,
because we want it to look less historic than it is now.
Well, I like that historic. It adds to the charm of the town for sure. But I just wonder if that went to how it was going to impact overall to anybody that wanted to buy a home next door to me. It seemed like there's nobody been there for a while, and they're trying to sell it, and that's cool. So I'm wondering, does this make it even slower?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. But the thoughts.
I'm from Korea, Presbyterian Church on the 7th Street, 7th Main Street. We are trying to renovate and restore that clock tower with some kind of defacing and all, but the cost is very high. And relating to this question, I want to see the availability
funding.
Of funding if it is designated as a historical.
That property, and I don't think that's one of the printouts over there, but that property might very well, I'd have to look, might very well qualify for National Register of Historic Places, which would mean that you could get federal funding.
But that will limit our ability to renovate or exterior.
Of the exterior.
Yeah. But only the front that's visible from the street. You could do anything you want in the back and the kids see without any restriction, or as long as it's not building code.
Yes.
So just to, I have to follow up with the committee or for the funding of it.
Well, let's look at, so did you sign in with your email at the front?
Yeah.
Yeah, so maybe we could email you the property sheet for the church and see if it was recommended for National Historic Register, and then we can find out if we can go through that process to get it listed. So I'm wondering if there's something
to that. Yeah. I just wanted to comment on that and then also ask a question. Massachusetts has preservation funds, but you do have to go through the state, and it's a 50-50 match. So you could apply through the state of Massachusetts for preserving your building by fixing the plaque, but also through the town, I'm pretty sure you could apply for community preservation funds to do the matching. But
if it's a private building, I'm not sure that you can get CPC funds.
But it is historic, so but is this something we're looking into for the Historical Society? Because ours is a private building.
Yours is too, okay.
But it's historic. It's, you know.
Well, let's start that when CPC funds be used for private buildings.
Right.
I thought that they could not, but if they can, that would be.
Well, I mean, it's something to explore. But my question was, how about the zoning? Because, it's business one zoning on B, from the middle of B Street back towards, the State Park. That's all business. And I think Clackwood Street is also business one also. But A Street is not. A Street is still residential. B Street, this side of B Street is residential, but the line goes right down the middle of B Street, and all of C and Walcott Valley and all of that. That's all zoned business.
Well, we have current properties that are zoned business that are in the district. Like the houses around the common, I think, is residential, but we have the Harvey and Gourmet's in the district, and the Pin Fire Restaurant is in the district. So I don't know that it matters which zoning district. But that could be maybe that's a place where we draw the line. If people felt that the business part of the street didn't need to be in the district, we could make that the line if we were.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I have a question. So if you expand the historic area to include what you want to propose in this map, if you own a house there that's 10 years old, 5 years old, 30 years old, or 100 years old, do they all have to comply to the restrictions of the historic?
Well, they would all have to come under review, but most likely for a newer home. So we can issue a certificate of appropriateness, a certificate of non-applicability, or a certificate of hardship. So they all have to apply through us, but often we would probably issue a certificate of non-applicability if it was a 10-year-old home and they just wanted to do something minor. Let's see. If a 10-year-old home wanted to do an addition in the front that came super close to the street, houses in the street are, you know, 20 feet from the street, that would fit in with the streetscape. But there wouldn't really be too much restriction on the existing home that's pretty new. We're not trying to make it look more historic, we just want to not make it look less historic than it does.
So also, if you owned an empty lot, what would you be able to build?
Well, it would come under us for design review, because right now, when you're building just a single residential home, you don't go through the design review board. That's only for big subdivisions. So it would come before us for design review, and we would be looking for something usually that fit within the streetscape, so that at least the front was a similar size and similar distance from the street, and a similar look, even though new materials. But then the back, you know, they could do whatever they want in the back.
So just to offer my opinion, I'm against anything that restricts homeowners' rights. I think if you own a property, you should be able to do whatever you want to do in terms of repairs or whatever, without having your hands tied. I've read a lot of the comments while I was sitting here waiting, and I think there's a lot of comments that the town has changed. If you haven't lived here for 50 years, we're no longer at the point. Everybody moves here in 5 years, I've been here 10 years, and I love it because it's clean. They didn't live here when it was clean. It's too late. Yeah, when we sold Western Nurseries and Legacy started, I think, it just in my opinion, for living here for 63 years, that horse left the barn a long time ago. And I don't think you can get that back by restricting people's properties and telling them, you know, what they can do, or color they can do, or whatever. It's a nice idea, but it's too little too late.
I respectfully disagree with that, and we're not talking 5 years, we're really talking 500 years. If you go to Europe, you see towns that are 500 years old, and it's a completely different mindset that goes with that. But while this is in the right direction, there are issues involved with that. And I'm understanding that it parallels, to some degree, what was done with a Wood Street. So can you share with us what that experience was like with the homeowners there, what you've learned from the Wood Street designation as historic district?
So there's a different, there's a Woodville Historic District Commission, which none of us are on, but so Woodville is just along Wood Street, I believe, and they have fewer restrictions than we do in the downtown area. They don't look at paint color in Woodville. So I can't comment too much about it since I'm not on that commission and don't see what comes before them. Yeah, Woodville, they don't look at lighting fixtures, roof materials, or roof color as well, and they don't look at paint at all.
Okay, so that's interesting that it would be more restrictive. Is that to say that the restrictions that you would have downtown here in Hawkington are the same as we would see in downtown areas of neighboring towns, or more restrictive, or less restrictive?
So if I'm looking at, it varies really from town to town. A lot of towns don't look at the paint color, and that's something we could consider removing from our list, if that's a sticking point for a lot of people. Beth's been looking at design guidelines from other towns. Some of them are super strict.
Yeah, and really, really strict. And I think what we were trying to go is something that wasn't that way, because we just don't feel that that's going to work for us. And part of why we're having this is to hear what people think should be the guidelines.
Like when the bylaw was written, we hadn't thought about solar panels. We talked about roof antenna for television, but that's not really a thing anymore. So we need to revise our bylaw a little bit too to see what things need to be exempt now. Because solar panels, we don't mention them at all, so presumably we review them. But they are temporary, so they might have them for 10, 20 years, and then they could just come right off. It's not really removing a piece of architecture. But we haven't decided anything about that. And if we did make a change, we would go to town meeting.
Just a follow-up. So how would that apply to the commercial structure? For example, the mill that was on Hayden Row, between Hayden Row and Church Street, that was acquired by firm that is converting it over to, when they're, I'm not sure what the timeline is, but I think their intent is to convert it over to condominiums.
Yeah.
So that
same understanding.
Yeah, they would still have anything visible from the street and the public way in the district would be subject to our review. But it's already looking pretty modern, so we would have to, we would make them go back to how it used to be.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Sorry if you have any questions. How much more time would this add to somebody's, if they wanted to do some work in the house, what would the process be? Planning board first, you know, just design review. How much more time would this add to somebody that wanted to do work?
So if they would apply for their permit for whatever work they wanted to do, the town hall should tell them if it required a start review or not. Like interior electrical work would not change anything, but they still have to get their electrical inspection. And if they're painting, it's like just 25 and 35 Main Street recently were repainted. They didn't even have to come before us because they were just repainting the same color. So routine maintenance is exempt. Let's see, color paint, if white or the same color that it is. Walk strides and ways and sidewalks, assuming that they're similar type as they were before, don't come before us. Storm windows and doors don't come before us. Window air conditioners, antenna don't come before us. And we probably should add something about satellite panels, or satellite additions and solar panels, because those are all common.
What if they wanted to put in air conditioning central here? Then you've got a unit that's
permanent
in your house. That's permanent. That would go before you guys.
It's not listed. That's one of the things that we talked about in one of our
that we might
get. And I think we were leaning towards no because we're trying not to be
too restrictive
because I have like all the restrictions. So we were. That's what we were talking about.
Yeah.
The things that solar panels and air conditioning and things that people need in modern life.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah,
okay. I have a couple questions. Mm-hmm. I realize you couldn't do the whole area at one time.
Yeah.
Where did you plan on starting?
Oh, so we have a map.
Oh, yeah, I looked at the map. Please tell me the area. Mm-hmm.
So it's it's like Ash Street, Haven Row, Grove Street, and then those side streets, Maple and Fenton.
Okay.
And also
the next part is whose idea was this to start this street?
So in 1989, a consultant recommended to us that we expand further. So the historic district was created in 1979. In 1989, they did a property survey and they recommended a certain number of homes be added. Then another survey was done in 2016 and they recommended even more. And then it's an action item in the master plan for us to consider expansion. So we thought we need to get the public feedback and see if they really want it or don't. And everybody gets to vote in town meeting.
How much time are you given before you drop it?
Huh?
How much time are you allowed before you drop this whole thing?
Well, we can bring it back every year if we want it, but we're trying to do these three forums.
And then hold it off for 5 years. I'm expecting 5 more years, and then I don't give a damn.
Yeah. But it all depends on these. We're having the three forums, and if everybody says they don't want it, we'll drop it. But everybody's
just like recommendations.
Yeah.
Obviously, you didn't solicit the homeowners in these areas.
So
their personal opinion.
So we had a consultant. Well, this is what we're doing now, soliciting feedback from the homeowners. And it won't go to town meeting if the homeowners all tell us they don't want it. But it's a historical preservation consultant recommended by the Mass Historical Commission. We did a report in 1989. We did a report in 2016.
So can you build something in there for someone in the recommended areas?
Well, that's why we're getting your feedback. And like I said, if everybody on one street doesn't want to be out, then we can just not have them.
What is the, your procedural standard? How do you measure if everyone is opposing, or how do you decide?
Well, that's why we did a mailing to every property owner, and we asked them to fill out the survey and to come to these forums. And so it'll depend on people speaking up. If we don't hear from people, we don't really know what they want. But we assume they received the mailing.
So after the hearing, what is your time frame and procedure? Town meeting?
So we'll see. We have a regularly scheduled meeting every month. So we'll have one in October and we'll talk about what happened here in October. And then at our November meeting, all three forms will have been done. And we should have a good sense of if we want to proceed or not. thought about trying to get it happening in 2019, but if it seems like people don't want it, we could wait until coming in 2020, you know, whatever. Depending on
what you feel. Amy, I'm Mike Verhoeven. I'm chairman of the Historical Commission in town, and I'm a resident of the downtown historic district. It was my idea.
How many years have you had?
35 years ago.
Yeah?
Yes. I respect, I'm not Italian, I've been told that.
Neither am I, I've only been here 55 years, but my husband grew up in this town, so the curse is on me.
But I have encouraged the Historical Commission to submit for a grant from the Mass Historical Commission, which we received. So the grant pays for half of the historical study. To the area to expand the district. And I personally am an advocate of the district. I think it preserves the integrity of the character of this town. And I think that's an important issue that for all of us homeowners who want to keep the character intact, this is a tool that you can use. This is not a detriment to your ownership. In fact, if you look, there are studies that say property values increase in historic districts. So if you're worried about your property value, it will actually go up according to a lot of studies. If this will all be determined by vote at the town meeting. So this is not something that can be dictated or determined by any individual committee. This is by vote. So Amy's doing a great job in the historic district is seeking input. So it's valuable to listen. Hopefully the final solution is something that everyone can find.
To your point, you're talking about existing structures. You're not talking about land that hasn't been built or developed yet.
Right.
And that's where property values can be affected.
Well, I can't speculate on that, but yes, I appreciate everyone has a concern and perhaps there's something that can be written in about, you know, limited liability over new work. And the intent in a historical district is to preserve the character of what's already there. It's not intended to supersede planning board or design review board or other agencies within the town that already have the governance and authority to oversee new work. So this is, in my opinion, this is just my opinion, that it's intended to try to protect the character that's already here. Not impose restrictions on new construction. That's my opinion.
Is there a fee to go before the historic?
I don't think so.
Okay. And how long does it typically take to get a project through?
It's less than a month. So let's see. We considered changing the bylaw a little bit. The way it's written is that when we get an application, we have 14 days to public hearing, you have to give the public at least 14 days notice of the public hearing, so that could put you out to about a month. But we'd like to change it so that, because some things that come before us really don't need a public hearing. Like one on street wanted to put new gutters on, and they were the same color, same type, really did not need a public hearing. So we said that would be fine, or we skipped certificate of, I think, non-applicability to them. And then neighbors had to be notified of our decision, and after 10 days it went into effect that they could do it. So, our goal is to get people through within a month, but we do have receptive local within a month.
So is it something that you have to notify 150 feet of your neighbors by registered letter and all that at the expense of the homeowner?
It is, it's funny, I don't know about the expense, we should ask that question. But it's not the 300 feet rule, it is adjoining properties, so they have to be bordering or directly across the street. So it's a smaller group of neighbors that have to be notified.
Yeah, just hate to see an added expense for anybody that wants to put gutters on or something simple, knowing that you have to do all the other things, jump through all the other hoops and pay all the other fees to get a building permit, get things inspected.
So we should clarify with town hall what the fees are, if they have to pay for postage or not.
Yeah, trees. Does it restrict trees though?
No, we're not allowed to restrict landscaping.
So if the tree's been there 150 years, it's in your way, just
yeah, we can't. we unfortunately can't protect it. Less than anyone. Yeah. No, so we don't review landscaping or trees at all.
Does that include stone wall?
So let's see, stone wall I guess would be a permanent structure, right? I don't think we have too many in the district at all right now.
Do you want to ask you?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And that street is a scenic road though, right? Mm-hmm. So that's stone wall is on a scenic road would be reviewed by the planning board, not the historic district. And the same for trees on the right of way on a scenic road.
Okay. And relating to that cloud tower project our church has, in order for us to preserve our existing spirit, a lot of the people, so we have to restore that, but the cost is prohibitive at this point. That's why we delayed for a couple of years. We start looking at it about a couple of years ago, but a lot of recommendations from the contractors are just to demolish it and just build a new one. It's a lot cheaper. Like if this is enforced, we try to preserve the beautiful exterior, yeah. But like the cost is an issue in our case. And if this is enforced, then we are really bound by some rules and regulations, and our hands are tied. And in case we don't have the funding, then really.
So one option if we don't have funding is to apply for a certificate of hardship. Which would mean that the only way to save the building is to allow it to be done. Like, why don't, like, say you, the trim was all rotten in the house, and the only, they just couldn't say that the only thing they could do was put vinyl on top of it, and you would apply for a certificate of hardship, and like, there's no way we can not demolish. That's all we can afford is to cover with vinyl.
It's not just the wood railing, but also the wooden shutters, and everything including the whole apartment. And the painters, they did not want to paint it.
They're afraid to paint it.
Because there is no warranty.
So we had a question recently from One Ash Street about composite materials that look like original wood and cardboard. Is that better?
I have that quote, but that's...
Is that better?
That's about $150,000 to the paint.
Having your roof redone, shutters, gutters replaced, is that considered routine or would that need to be approved?
So I think gutters do come before us, but if it's the same type as existing, we would normally just allow it without even a hearing, just a regular meeting. And only if they're visible from the street.
Yeah, it's visible from the street.
And the same thing, if the roof is the same material and color, we would just say,
so do you have some guidelines that explain what routine maintenance is? Because I might think it's routine, but you know, with gutters, and then all of a sudden be fine or whatever, not knowing that, oops.
So I think that's going to be a big part of this process, is getting our written design guidelines so people can read them and be comfortable with them or not.
Can I ask a question about the color? This is just a general question. Your house is in the historic district, and you and your six neighbors all have seven different roof colors. And you want to put a new roof on, and you want the color of your neighbor across the street, which has been approved. Are you going to get denied because you want a different color and it wasn't your own color?
So I don't think we've ever denied anyone for something like that.
I mean, it just seems like,
you have to put like
why would you even regulate a roof color?
You know? Some roof colors really don't fit in with the historic district. There's some really bright colors that you can put in.
I think that's an important point though. If you're in a historic district and somebody comes in and wants to put up an orange roof, you know, innovations happen all the time, beauty's in the eye of the, you know, the homeowner on that, this is what allows for it.
No, I just meant if it was a color that had already been approved.
Right, no, I'm
wanted
yeah.
Partially why we wanted to have this discussion and come up with these guidelines so that there would be something written down so that when we rotate out, it will still be there.
easy for homeowners that not that burden.
They would be 36 Ash, which would be in the proposed district. A couple things on the roof. I think a typical issue that comes up is historic building might have a black roof on it, and for energy efficiency, when it's redone, someone might want to go with a light gray or white just to be more reflective. So would that require approval in order to do that?
You'd be prepared to come before the board, but we would usually be pretty accepting of something like that. It's more than if you want to do the color that's not seen anywhere in the district.
Up on the screen up there, it says blocks, driveways, and sidewalks, same type. We've got a gravel driveway. If I wanted to put pavers down or pave that, I would have to get approval.
We have to come before the board, yeah.
And we live on a corner lot, so all sides are visible. You know, the first point there is the exterior change is not visible. There, in the proposed areas that you have, you have a lot of short streets and a lot of intersections. A high proportion of these houses are corner lots. So there's basically everything's got to be reviewed. And to say that, I've been through the experience of exterior changes not visible. You know, saying it's only exterior, I was once in a situation where we wanted to build a center entrance colonial, and the historic district said, no, we have to move the door. So 20 years later, that door comes right into the living room. It's not at the stairway. So it sounds like it's okay, but there are implications for that. And people need to be aware of that. Just to say it's exterior, oh, you don't have to worry about it. Exterior, especially on an old house, has huge areas on what your options are. I mean, you don't, those old houses are not laid out in conventional current ways. And, you know, you've got bearing walls and all this kind of stuff. So it can be very, very restricting.
Yeah, we wondered about the side street issue too, if people are on corner lots, might be more affected. And what should we do about that? So I'll have to see if there's a way we can word it. Yeah, I'd have to ask the town council about that. Is there a way we can word it so we can really, the facade is really what we're mostly concerned about. But right, some could be a corner mounted fence or something.
Is there a way to speed up the process if there's an emergency, if somebody's house burns and they have to do some paperwork quickly? Or a few years ago when everybody had to repair the roofs because of the hailstorms, if you're, you know, hands are tied, you gotta wait a month to have a meeting and all of a sudden you got a whole new roof from a fire, but you've got somebody that can replace the roof now, is there a way you can speed that process up so you don't have to wait a month? Because it's the dead of winter. And
we had one like that last winter. We did meet within, I think, 10 days of when he applied, and then we approved it right away, and then we had to notify the neighbors another 10 days before it went into effect.
Kill somebody there. That's 20 days, minimum, or a month. It's wintertime, the pipe's freezing, you know, you got a whole new roof. There should be some way that you don't have to go through the process. I mean, nobody's going to want to have an extraordinary event happen. Does, I think you should be exempt from the whole process.
So we have to define that then, I guess, what would, how severe does it have to be before they can just skip the process entirely? So I'll come retroactively.
So to clarify, wouldn't the process be retroactive, knowing that you're in the historic district, going forth with it, and then just checking to make sure that it was consistent?
I'm going to have to ask Melanie Lazarus what she thinks. Then everybody would do it, right? They would just do it and just forgive us later. Or they could. But there should be some right guidelines.
There's a reasonableness check that goes with that. Homeowner does have to address the short-term issue. And as long as what they're doing is consistent, I would think that would be illegal to repair your home in an emergency as long as you're replacing the roof with something consistent instead of putting up a pink roof. Yeah. Just to make sure that I'm understanding the wavelength on that, if you replaced an asphalt, hypothetically for today, so if we were coming before you to replace an an asphalt drive all the way with a patio driveway, would that pass?
So I can't speak for the board, but I can't imagine.
No, it's just hypothetical. I'm not at all sure what that.
Yeah.
But that's the kind of thing that would pass, right?
Right.
Oh, okay, great. Thank you.
Question for you on timeline. So you mentioned that this would get voted at town meeting. If that gets approved at town meeting, how quickly would this be enacted? Is this, like, what's your goal for times on this? It goes from town meeting in November and it's approved and enacted in December. Like, I'm just trying to get a that gauge of
so the absolute time. Earliest it could happen would be at the May town meeting. So it's the first Monday in May. And then it has to go to the Attorney General, I believe, to approve any bylaw changes to be approved. So probably wouldn't take effect till late summer of 2019. So that'd be the earliest. If we feel like people don't really want it, we might push it off till time, maybe May 2020.
So what are you thinking of petitioning the homeowners to ask them their opinions?
Well, we sent all the property owners a letter, so we're
suggesting that we need to ask them yes or no, do they want to be in it or not? If they haven't, if they don't want to be in it, you need to know that.
Right, so we sent them a survey specifically asking, do you want your street to be in the district? Yeah. And we're keeping it open through October, so we go all.
Okay, so the end of October is the deadline for you to get a response from all the homeowners?
We asked for October 5th, because we would have a meeting October 11th, but we're going to have time to review the results before our next meeting.
Have you gotten any responses then?
We have 62 responses. The survey results so far are on the same answer.
Yeah, they're on the on this back row. There's some copies that we sent out.
To everybody, all property owners and all homes in the expansion district. I can't recall how many that was, but the town hall keeps a record of all the property owners and their mailing addresses. Because sometimes the owner doesn't live in the building, so we go to the owner rather than the resident.
So is this considering a zoning change at town meeting, so it would require 2/3 vote?
It's a general bylaw, the historic district bylaw.
So I wondered if it's a bylaw or zoning, I guess.
Well,
2/3 or simple majority?
I swear I thought it was a zoning.
It seems like it would be, that it's in the general bylaw.
So
yeah, so we can clarify if it's 2/3 or 50%.
Simple majority, which I'm just curious.
I'm sorry, so what was that point that they would pass?
So zoning bylaw changes require a 2/3 vote at town meeting.
At town meeting, so it's not an overall town vote.
Everybody should vote for kind of town meeting.
At town meeting.
Yeah. But general bylaws only require a 50% or 51% majority vote. And this is part of the general bylaws, so I think it would be a 51% vote needed. But all registered voters are welcome to come vote at the town meeting. Everyone. And speak. Any other questions or comments? Anything we missed that we didn't write down correctly? Right, so it's all
prepared. Sharpie's ready. Anything about
donations? Yeah, please do email us. Yeah.
Or email us.
Yeah. Or come to the next forum or meeting.
Will you have some of these answers by then?
Oh, I hope so. Oh, yeah. Okay. I think some of them are pretty good. Well, that should be an easy one to get. Yeah. 2/3.
And when and where is the next meeting?
October. So the next meeting is Thursday, October 11th at 7:00 at the town hall in the selectmen's big meeting room. Then we're having one more forum Thursday, November 1st at 7:00 at the HKM studios. And we're asking HKM to record all of them because we know the cannabis companies. I want to make sure everyone's comments are recorded. Thank you very much, and we'll stick around if you have individual questions. And if you own one of the properties, we did print out some of the new record sheets, and if we didn't print yours out, they are available.